Very well.
Be done. It has begun. Very well. Very well.
Let's go.
By the Maker, we're saved!
You weren't sent by the Ban, were you? To save us? So we could have just starved down here? The Ban gave up on us? I suppose I should be grateful that someone came at all, then. Thank you. But if you weren't sent by someone, why are you here? If you don't mind me asking. A control rod? Do you mean the one for Shale? That damnable golem brought us nothing but trouble. My mother sold the rod years ago after it killed my father, and good riddance! My father's name was Wilhelm, mage to the Arles of Redcliffe and a hero in the war against Orlais, and what did he get? One day, my mother found him outside the tower, with so many broken bones she could barely recognize him, and Shale standing over him just like it is now. My father deserved better than that. But if you really want to wake Shale up, well, it's yours now. This was my father's laboratory, beneath his tower. Or it was, anyhow. Look, I know you probably have more important things on your mind, but I really need your help. I know you already saved my life, and I'm grateful, but my daughter is inside the laboratory. She was afraid and ran too far in before I could stop her. I don't know how she made it past my father's defenses. One of the men tried to go after her. He was killed, but you could find her, couldn't you? You will? Thank the Maker! My father's laboratory is just past the next area, I think. She has to be there.
As you say. It shall be done.
Thank you. Someone's come to play. You have come to play, haven't you? We're playing a guessing game. It's better with more people. Kitty and me, of course. You don't see anyone else here, do you? Anyway, you should go if you're not going to play. Kitty finds you distracting. Kitty's clever. She says you want to take me back to my father, but I'm not going. She would be lonely.
I would not suggest leaving in such hostile company anyhow, Amalia. Look how they act.
Of course, silly.
Talking is simple enough, once you know how. I am a cat, really. Nothing you say will convince Amalia to go with you. She loves only me now. I am her friend, while you are just a stranger. I have done nothing. I am all but powerless. The mage made sure of that, didn't he? I cannot leave this chamber. No, Amalia found me. After decades of isolation, her company is... welcome. It seems we are at an impasse, so let me propose a compromise of sorts. Release me, mortal, and let me have the girl. Let us return to her father, and leave this place forever. That's such a crude way of putting it. I do not wish to harm Amalia. I merely want to see your world through her eyes. Is that so wrong? But I do like this one.
I like you too, Kitty.
But if it means escaping this prison, I am willing to leave on my own. I agree to your terms. The mage's wards hold me within this chamber, and only a mortal may approach them. There is a trick to disarming the wards, but I do not know it. Perhaps you will succeed where the girl failed.
Oh, this is so exciting! Kitty is going to be free! I always wanted a cat, and Kitty is so perfect and pretty.
Very well.
I like it when Kitty sings to me.
Very well. It shall be done. It is begun.
Father doesn't like cats, but he never met Kitty.
I shall do it. As you say.
Room. Isn't that awful?
shall be done.
Kitty is my best friend.
Very well. It shall be done. It is begun.
I was thinking about the sun, silly.
I shall do it. It is begun. I shall do it. Very well.
Tell me a story.
I shall do it. It shall be done. Very well.
Oh, it's a flower. Is it a daffodil? I like daffodils.
I shall do it. As you say.
I was thinking about the sun, silly.
It is begun. It shall be done. I shall do it. I shall do it. Shall be done.
Father doesn't like cats, but he never met Kitty.
Say. Very well. It is begun.
Kitty says Grandpa Wilhelm locked her up in this room. Isn't that awful?
Very well. Very well. As you say. Very well.
I've always wanted a cat, and Kitty is so perfect and pretty.
I shall do it. Very well.
I was thinking about the sun, silly. Tell me a story.
I shall do it. As you say.
I shall do it. Very well. Very well. It shall be done. It is begun.
Tell me a story.
Begun.
I was thinking about the sun, silly.
As you say. I shall do it. As you say.
Story.
I shall do it. Very well.
Kitty says Grandpa Wilhelm locked her up in this room. Isn't that awful?
As you say.
Oh, it's a flower. Is it a daffodil? I like daffodils.
I shall do it. As you say. I shall do it.
He's my best friend.
I shall do it. I shall do it. Begun.
Yes. I can feel the magic fading. Oh, I had forgotten how it feels not to be caged.
Kitty? What's happening?
A wonderful thing, my dear, for both of us. I have changed my mind. I like the girl. I do not think I will find another like her.
Oh, so I get to go with you after all?
Ugh, I will take her anyhow. She is mine.
Kitty! You're scaring me! I won't let you inside me! I won't!
Yes.
Dear, thank you so much!
I'm sorry I ran away, Daddy. I was so scared.
It's all right, Butterfly. You're safe now. All the bad creatures are gone. You'll need a phrase to activate, Shale. It's Doolan Han. I wouldn't want the thing, but it's obvious you can handle yourself just fine. Now we should go, and quickly. Thank you again. We owe you our lives.
What we are looking at is a golem. It would appear it is defunct, though there may be a way to revive it yet.
I knew that the day would come when someone would find the control rod. And not even a mage this time. Probably stumbled across the rod by accident, I suppose. Typical. So it knew what it was doing. Shocking. I stood here in this spot and watched the wretched little villagers scurry around me for, oh, I have no idea how long. Many, many years.
And the villagers had no idea they were being watched. Creepy.
Then one wonders that you wouldn't be grateful to the one who allowed you to stretch your legs, Gollum.
Hmm. Another mage, I see. Charming. I was just beginning to get used to the quiet, too. Tell me, are all the villagers dead? Some got away, then. How unfortunate. Perhaps I may have forgotten after all the years of being called Gollum. Gollum, fetch me that chair. Do be a good Gollum and squash that insipid bandit. And let's not forget, Gollum, pick me up. I tire of walking. It does have the control rod, doesn't it? I am awake, so it must. I see the control rod, yet I feel... Go on. Order me to do something. And, nothing. I feel nothing. I feel no compulsion to carry out its command. I suppose this means the rod is... broken? Hmm. I suppose if I can't be commanded, this means... I have free will, yes? It is simply... what should I do? I have no memories beyond watching this village for so long. I have no purpose. I find myself at a bit of a loss. What about it? It must have awoken me for some reason, no? What did it intend to do with me? May I ask what sorts of things it gets up to for which I could be so potentially useful? It refers to the Darkspawn, the very creatures that destroyed this village. The Darkspawn are an evil that must be destroyed, it's true, though not as evil as the birds. Damnable feathered fiends. I suppose I have two options, do I not? Go with it or go elsewhere? I do not even know what lies beyond this village.
Are you certain you want to bring that thing with us? It could be dangerous and large. Good point. Better it than me, anyhow.
I will follow it about then, for now. I am called Shale, by the way. This should be interesting.
Vashadin.
Yes.
Blasted.
Yes.
Pigeon crap. Yes.
Vashadin.
Pigeon crap. Yes.
Yes.
It has begun.
I have been studying Mother's grimoire. Do you wish to hear what I have found? 'Tis not what I expected. I had hoped for a collection of her spells, a map of the power that she commands. But this is not it. Disturbed? Yes, perhaps that is the right word. One thing in particular within her writings disturbs me. Here, in great detail, Flemeth explains the means by which she has survived for centuries. Oh, if only 'twere so. Flemeth has raised many daughters over her long lifetime. There are stories of these many witches of the wilds throughout chastened legend, yet I have never seen a one, and always wondered why not. And now I know. They are all Flemeth. When her body becomes old and wizened, she raises a daughter, and when the time is right, she takes her daughter's body for her own. I do not know. Perhaps 'tis as she said, the Darkspawn threaten her as much as they threaten anyone else. Or perhaps she believes that this journey will make me more powerful. According to the tome, if the host is already powerful and trained in magic, it takes far less time for Flemeth to settle in. There is only one possible response to this. Flemeth needs to die. I will not sit about like an empty sack waiting to be filled. Flemeth must be slain, and I need your help to do it. Then what needs to be done is for you to go back to Flemeth's hut in the Kakari Wilds without me. If I am present when she is slain, I cannot be certain that she will not be able to possess my body right then. So I must remain at the camp, confront her, and slay her quickly. I doubt she will truly be dead even then, but it will take her years to find a new host and recover her power, if that is even possible. The thing I must have is her true grimoire. With it, I can defend against her power in the future. Everything else in her hut is yours. Not really, but the sooner the better, no? I am grateful. The sooner this can be done, the sooner it will set my mind at ease.
I have a question for it, if it will indulge me. My understanding is that it encountered the smith named Carradine, he who was responsible for the creation of the golems, that he had become a golem himself. What I do not know is what became of him. Why did he not return with it? I would have many questions for him. He killed himself? Ah, I would doubt it, but no, I see it is telling the truth. May I ask what became of the Anvil of the Void, assuming that it too still existed? Then it was no doubt for the best. With Carradine also goes any chance I might have had of finding answers on my past, I assume. Tell me, did it find out anything from Carradine? Anything at all about how I might have been made? Meaning that I was once a living creature? That seems highly unlikely, and more than a little insulting. Is it certain? Was I forced into this? Or simply glad to abandon a frail body? And more importantly, who was I? I simply must know. I cannot help but believe that answers lie elsewhere in the Deep Roads. We must look. If it can search the Deep Roads, I may remember something. If not, then I will have to wait.
Oh, it's been a long day. Rest. Rest would be welcome. Yes, of course. I am just a little weary.
As you may have noticed, I'm no spring chicken. Very funny. But in all honesty, I do not know how many years I have left in me. I have lived for such a long time, but there is always something else to do. And I have to keep going in order to do it. I think I will be glad when I am done. Oh, no. I'm not the sort of person that leaves things unfinished. I'll see this through, I promise. Have you encountered many abominations, apart from the ones in the Circle Tower? The first time I saw an abomination, my blood turned to ice. It was months before the nightmares stopped. It was the knowledge that I could easily become one of them that frightened me the most. Every mage is vulnerable, no matter how accomplished or powerful. That is the first thing we learn, and overconfidence can lead to recklessness. One slip. All it takes is one slip, and everything you are is simply gone. Replaced by madness. And there is no turning back, or at least that's what they say. Of late, I have begun to wonder if there is any way an abomination can be cured. Or if a mage could be so possessed and still retain their sanity, their humanity. Yes, it is madness and cruelty that define abominations. If those are lacking, if the mage remembers the person they truly are, then they are not an abomination. I never saw that. Thank you for showing me another way of looking at it.
Yes.
Indeed.
Yes.
Thank you.
I fell. For a moment there, I thought I was... I thought it was all over. I will explain everything when we are back at camp. Now is not the time.
And so you return. Lovely Morrigan has at last found someone willing to dance to her tune. Such enchanting music she plays, wouldn't you say? Which one, I wonder? What has Morrigan told you? Hmm? What little plan has she hatched this time? Oh, there are many, many reasons to kill Flemeth. More than you know. But if I am to guess, I would say Morrigan has discovered something. Something shocking that requires her defense. Yes? Ah, but it is an old, old story. One that Flemeth has heard before, and even told. Let us skip right to the ending, shall we? Do you slay the old wretch as Morrigan bids, or does the tale take a different turn? Choice. There is power in choices, as there is in lies. I shall give you one of each. Morrigan wishes my grimoire. Take it as a trophy. Tell her I am slain. Shame. What will it be, then? It is a dance poor Flemeth knows well. Let us see if she remembers the steps. Come, she will earn what she takes. I'd have it no other way.
Yeah.
I think I owe you an explanation for what happened earlier. You should know that something happened to me at the tower before you came along. You spoke to Petra, did you not? She told you I saved her from a demon. I did, but I did not survive that encounter. Let me explain fully. I engaged a very powerful demon to rescue Petra. It sapped me of all my energy and will and left me drained. It took everything I had to defeat it. And when I was done, I no longer had the strength to keep my heart beating. I remember my life ebbing away. Everything receded from me. Sound, light. I remember being enveloped in complete, impenetrable darkness. And then I sensed a presence enfolding me and cradling me, whispering quietly to me. The sensation is impossible to describe. I was being held back firmly but gently, as a mother would a child eager to slip from her grasp. I felt life and warmth flowing through my veins again. I began to be aware of small sounds and the discomfort of my hip pressing into the cold stone of the tower floor. The Fade contains spirits both benevolent and malicious. The benevolent spirits seldom make themselves known, because they want nothing from mortals, unlike the demons. It was one of these spirits that saved me. Without it, I would be dead. And it has not left me. It is with me, even now, bonded to me. You see, I am supposed to be dead. It is the spirit that is keeping me in this world. And this is not the way of things. Perhaps the spirit did not expect this, but it is weakening gradually. I am living on borrowed time. Yes, that we will. So, tell me, how did you become a Grey Warden?
Arl Rendon Howe, the Arl of Amaranthine. Why would he do such a thing to you?
You are the last of the Kuslands? I had no idea. My lord?
Yes, I suppose so. You can no longer have a title, can you? But that does not mean you must forget utterly where you came from. Take heart, dear friend. You survived, even when you were not expected to. We do not know yet what lies in store for you, or the name you carry. It is not so bad, is it, being a Grey Warden?
Sometimes it gives me comfort to think that everything will end up the way it's supposed to. That it will be all right. You were chosen. You survived the joining when others did not. Perhaps it was meant to be. I must ask, what does being a Grey Warden mean to you?
There's that, of course. But there's more to being a Grey Warden than killing Darkspawn and saving the world from the Blight.
Ultimately, being a Grey Warden is about serving others. About serving all people, whether elves or dwarves or men. As a Grey Warden, you are a guardian of men. And you guard them because their continued existence is more important than you are. Thus it is you who serves, not they. A good king, a true king who cares for his land, uses his power to rule firmly but fairly. He serves his people first and foremost. The king who does not do this, who believes that he is entitled to his power, who abuses it and uses it for his own means, is a tyrant. If you live apart from others and your actions affect only you, then you may do as you wish. But if you have power, influence, and strength, your every action will be as a drop of water in a clear sea. With that fellow Alice, the drop causes allegiance to a king or lord. Think of how far they will go, how wide they will become, how will they affect the pond. But I've lectured enough for today. I should stop before I wear out my welcome. You're quite taken with each other, aren't you? I've noticed your blossoming relationship, and I wanted to ask you where you thought it was going. Leliana is a remarkable girl, sincere and guileless, and she has opened her heart to you. I would not like to see her hurt. Not intentionally, no. But there is great potential for tragedy here, for one or both of you. You are a Grey Warden. You have responsibilities which supersede your personal desires. Love is ultimately selfish. It demands that one be devoted to a single person who may fully occupy one's mind and heart to the exclusion of all else. A Grey Warden cannot afford to be selfish. You may be forced to make a choice between saving your love and saving everyone else. And then what would you do? Nothing is certain. Not in these times. You cannot take anything for granted. I want you to be aware of this. I am just trying to minimize the suffering that may come to either of you. I have given my advice. Do with it what you will. What's on your mind? I have always had an affinity for the spirits of the Fade. As a child, I never feared my dreams because I knew they were there. I could sense the demons, too, and their presence frightened me. It was the kindly spirits of the Fade that took the fear from me. I've always been able to feel the spirits, even if I never saw them. And as I nurtured my talent in the Circle, I became more sensitive. I began to notice every time I was in the Fade, whether it was in a dream or in magical practice, that I was being watched. Sometimes I would see it, a glowing, nebulous form. Most times I would just feel its presence, gentle and comforting, but somehow alien. I think it is a spirit of faith. They have never been seen before, and perhaps I am wrong. But something tells me I'm not. It always felt like the same entity. This one spirit was curious about me, and was guarding me, for want of a better word. There were times when I was in the Fade that it seemed to stretch forth to shield me, keeping me safe. And I think it gave me strength in my most terrible battles, Ostagar being one of them. I don't know why I was chosen. Perhaps it knew that there was something more that lay in store for me. I like to think that I was given a rare chance. And I'm going to make the best of the time so generously given to me. I will not lie motionless in a bed with coverlets up to my chin, waiting for death to claim me. That is not the death for me. And so I will fight alongside the Grey Warden and help prepare him for the task that is yet before him. So you had better listen to me, because I swear, if I should fall before the end and you don't seem to be doing things properly, I'll get up again to give you a good finger-wagging. You know, I think you'll be all right, even without my help. What's on your mind? Cure me? What, am I sick now? Even you know that you cannot cure the dead. And I'm not the only one dying. You are too. I'm just more efficient about it. Ah, child. Your concern is heartwarming. But death comes to everyone, and it is not something to fear. People fear not death, but having life taken from them. Many waste the life given to them, occupying themselves with things that do not matter. When the end comes, they say they did not have time enough to spend with loved ones, to fulfill dreams, to go on adventures they only talked about. But why should you fear death if you are happy with the life you have led? If you can look back on everything and say, yes, I am content, it is enough. I think I've led a good life, a full life, and I, for one, am not afraid of death, whatever it may bring. They say that when you die, your spirit travels through the fade and returns to the Maker. And after that, we'll see, won't we?
So, full of questions, are you? Well, that depends, does it not? What does she seem to be? Oh, she is certainly old. Have no mistake of that.
Tell me, how much do you know of the tale? The one that the Chastened still tell of my mother, to frighten them into obedience? Ah, I see. That does explain much. I can relay what Flemeth once told me herself, and you can decide whether or not 'tis the truth, if you desire. As the tale is sung by the bards, there was a time when Flemeth was young and beautiful, a fair lass in a land of barbarian men, the desire of any who saw her. Many centuries before this land was even named Ferelden, the tales say that Flemeth fell in love with Osen the Bard and fled the castle of her husband, the Dreadlord Conobar, and that he swore vengeance for her infidelity. In truth, my mother claims that 'twas Osen who was her husband, and Conobar the jealous lord who looked on from afar. Lord Conobar approached young Osen and offered him wealth and power in exchange for his lovely wife, and Osen agreed. The life of a bard is a poor one, and love fades in the wake of hunger. 'Twas Flemeth who suggested the arrangement. All would have been well had Lord Conobar kept his end of the bargain. But he was a foul man who bargained with coin he did not possess. Osen was led off to a field and slain, left for dead. Flemeth spoke to the spirits and learned of the deed, and swore revenge. That was not the point. Conobar had no honor, so she would not have him. Flemeth begged the spirits to aid her, and 'twas they who slew Conobar. The demon the legend tells of came later. Lord Conobar's allies chased Flemeth, you see. Chased her to the wilds, and there she hid. There she found the demon, and he made her strong. The legends all speak of the great hero Cormac, he who defeated Flemeth and her great army when she invaded the lowlands centuries later. All lies. You would be surprised at how little my mother cares for what I or others think of her past. The truth of the matter is that there was never an invasion. As Flemeth tells it, the Chastened never raised an army under her banner, and she never fought with any warrior named Cormac. Cormac led a brutal civil war against his own people, and later claimed it was to vanquish evil that had taken root amongst the lords. Thus, he was hailed a hero. Flemeth was only attached to the legend much later. Perhaps 'twas due to the great war with the Chastened that eventually came, but Mother claims not to know how it began. Flemeth tells it with far more embellishment than I, but you are welcome. Dare I ask of your own mother? Few are abominations of legend, 'tis true, but I find myself curious nevertheless. Ah. Then you have my sympathies, for what it is worth. Which is very little, I am certain. It matters not. Let us move on.
Mother's real grimoire, is it? I am glad you were able to find it after all. My thanks for retrieving it. I shall begin studying it immediately and unlock the power that it holds.